On today's show,
can the Cavs force a Game 7, baby, or will the Warriors, with Draymond back in the mix, pop champagne?
Live from Cleveland, Lee Ellis tells us who he thinks will start for the Warriors.
And in Crossfire, we debate whether LeBron deserves Finals MVP regardless of the series outcome.
It's Thursday, June 16th. The Starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or joining us live on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube, we're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
Will the visitors' locker room smell like champagne once again?
We'll find out soon enough. Over there, Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Ayo!
Ayo!
And joining us live from Cleveland, one's the international man of mystery, the other, a TNT legend, Lee Ellis and Craig Sager. Lee.
Hey guys, yes, I'm very happy to be joined tonight by former TNT colleague, only for tonight though, who's working the sidelines for ESPN. But Craig, thanks for taking time. In all your career of working in the NBA, you've never worked an NBA Finals game. What does it mean to you tonight to get that opportunity?
Well, it's great because, you know, we're such an integral part of the NBA and we're the fabric and we live and die by it. And you go through the whole season, all of a sudden you finish the conference finals, you crown the conference final champion, and we have our post party. And oh yeah, the finals. Oh no, basketball's over. You know, time to go play golf. So there's always that void that I'd watch the games, I wanted to be part of it, and you know, I'd even go to some as a fan, but to be actually being able to take part of it and be there for the broadcast and have some small role, it means a lot. You know, it really does.
Does it make it even more special knowing that no matter what happens tonight, you won't have to interview Greg Popovich?
Well, I'll tell you what, Coach Pop has been great to me. He really has, and he's been a great supporter. And I would never say anything bad about Coach Pop. It's always a challenge to interviewing him, and I accept that challenge. I don't always get what I'm looking for, but he's a great guy. And fortunately, tonight I get to interview both coaches, so it'll be fun.
What is also always a challenge is what outfit you're going to wear. So what inspired this number tonight?
I was out. My closet was dry. I'd run the gamut. And I went home, and I got one more game. And, you know, it's an ABC game. It's for finals. I said, I got to come up with something. I looked in the closet. I said, I can't wear that. I already wore that. I can't wear that. And so I had to go shopping. So I scoured Atlanta, tried to find something that would be fitting for how to show how excited I am to be here. And so I actually found this at Neiman Marcus in Lenox Mall.
Well, I like it. I don't know if that's an endorsement or not, but I do like it.
How come you never wear sport coats?
Well, it's a little bit too casual for me. You know, this is my style.
Yeah, you're starting.
That's right. That's right. Anyway, thanks very much for your time. I know you're very busy. Good luck tonight.
Oh, no problem.
And all the best.
You can have it after tonight.
Great. Can't wait to wear it.
See. Oh, awesome.
Back to you guys.
Yeah, I can't wait to see Lee in that jacket. Thanks. Enjoy your first NBA Finals game there. Lee, we'll talk to you later. But tonight, Game 6 on ABC, defending champion Warriors. They hold the 3-2 lead. They can close out their second straight title, or a Cavs win would force Game 7 in Oakland on Sunday. But before we break it down here, a little throwback Thursday fun, TK.
Yeah, Skeets, thanks to a combination of 2016 being a leap year and additional travel days during this year's finals, today marks the exact one-year anniversary of the Golden State Warriors clinching the 2015 NBA title in Cleveland following a Game 6 win. And as we all know, the Warriors are in Cleveland right now hoping to clinch this year's title with a Game 6 win. Trippy, man. But it brings us to today's question about tonight's game. Do you think the NBA Finals are over, or are we going to Game 7, baby? We're going to be running a live poll throughout the show where you can pick the winner. If you think the Cavs are going to extend the series, tweet out hashtag StartersCavs. If you think the Warriors are going home as champions, tweet out hashtag StartersWarriors. And while you guys are getting your votes in, I'm going to ask these dudes here a few questions about tonight's Game 6. And our first question, LeBron James and Kyrie Irving both went for 41 points in the Cavs Game 5 win. So here's your first question. Can LeBron and Kyrie repeat their Game 5 performances?
That's a little ridiculous to ask them to do that again. That was the first time it's ever happened.
But can they?
Yeah, well,
but can they?
No, it's ridiculous to ask them to do that again. They shouldn't have to do that again.
Right.
And it's unlikely. Guys don't average 40 points in the finals. It just doesn't happen. So for them to do it over and over and over, it's too tough. LeBron knows he's got to get some other people involved. and it's got to be Kevin Love. And not to keep on poking the Kevin Love bear here, but he is capable of scoring a lot of points. And people who look at Game 5 and say, oh, he stunk, he only scored 2 points. Well, he shot the ball five times. How many points do you want him to score on five shots? Right. Four or five max if he's shooting a decent percentage. So the job is tonight to get Kevin Love going, because you can't continue to score 80-plus points between two guys and shoot over 60%, but K-Love can be there. What you have to do with K-Love, I think, to get him involved is go to him at the start of the game. You got to go to him at the post. Got to get him a three-point shot.
Just like they used to do with Chris Bosh.
Yeah, a little bit of that, because he's got to feel involved. Kevin Love said in the second half of that game with Andrew Bogut and Draymond Green out, it was basically get in the corners because we're going downhill with LeBron and Kyrie, and he wasn't involved. Not to make excuses for him, but he wasn't. That's why he didn't get going. I think LeBron and Kyrie know guys in finals history don't average 40 points. Get him involved.
Again, though, can they? Would you be all that shocked if these guys go for 35 or 40 against tonight? No, you wouldn't. Because one, in LeBron James, is one of already the greatest players of all time, who, by the way, puts up monster numbers time in and time out in elimination games. We know that. And Kyrie Irving, well, he's now scored 30, 34, and 41 in the last three games. He's rolling. And I don't know if there's a guy in the league that, when he's on, is just fire like Kyrie Irving. I mean, sure. Steph's there, Klay's there, but Kyrie's right there as well. So you're right. Do they want to do that? Do they think they need to bank on that? No, you're right. They need help. Either Love, J.R. Smith at home. He's been playing better, of course, in the postseason. Shumpert maybe, but I would not be shocked, especially from LeBron. You're going to see another 40, 15, 10 game. That's what he does in these sort of closeout situations.
Well, two things. You can't expect him to go for 40 each night because it just hasn't happened in the past. And because
he did it in last year's finals.
Well,
it's a two-man game with these two guys.
Exactly. So that means he's probably going to score a little bit less because they have to share. I mean, he had to shoot so much. Listen, it just doesn't happen. We like to go look at LeBron and say, hey, you're a massive man. You should score 45. It's not possible. Guys have off nights. Second thing, it wasn't a coincidence that he had his most shots of the series with Draymond Green out of the lineup.
Right, right.
That was a big part of it. That's why Kyrie Irving also had his series high, and that's why you have to get other guys involved. They didn't have their best defense out there, so that's why Kevin Love is huge. J.R. Smith, as you mentioned, is a big part of this as a starting guard out there. And Iman Shumpert, if he's out there because he took away Klay Thompson a little bit in the second half, he's probably going to play some minutes. Those three guys. But I think it starts with Kevin Love.
We'll see. Trey, next question.
All right, after J.R. Smith crashed into his leg early in the third quarter of Game 5, Andrew Bogut is going to miss the rest of the finals with an injured left knee. But here's your question. Could losing Andrew Bogut actually help the Warriors? What do you think?
I wouldn't say it would help the Warriors, but his minutes have decreased this entire series. Yeah. And I think the Warriors know they have to play small. So Bogut, if he was going to play at all, it was going to be a few minutes in this game. The Draymond Green solution is what they're going to go to. They have to play small. Draymond Green is their best lineup. You look up and down the lineup stats.
Yeah.
They smoke everyone, but it's just not sustainable to play him throughout the entire series, 42 or 43 minutes. So that's why Bogey starts each half, then goes to the bench and doesn't come back. That's why the Green solution will be the solution tonight. Even if he doesn't start, we're unclear as to who starts. Lee's going to tell us in a few minutes as to who thinks he gets the starting nod. Green will finish this game and he'll play plenty. I think personally they're just going to start Draymond Green and throw him out there, but there is the other option of throwing Festus Ezeli at the five, just like Bogut does, playing those minutes to start each half, and then Green plays the majority of minutes.
I actually think, and we don't know, but I actually think Kerr will go with Festus Ezeli as the starting center because he doesn't really think or maybe even want to play small for 48 minutes. I think that's a part of it, and the other part of it is, if you go small, okay, Barnes and Iggy and Draymond Green are your bigs, LeBron is going to see that and attack and attack and attack. I don't think Kerr wants those guys to get into foul trouble early. That's why you're sort of fine if Bogut, when he's playing, or Ezeli if he starts tonight, they pick up one, two, three fouls early. It's not the end of the world. You know you're going small later in the game, but you don't want those guys, especially Draymond or Iguodala, to pick up early fouls. So I would not be shocked by any means if Kerr goes with a big guy to start this.
That's a good point. I think Draymond Green is in the head a little bit of LeBron James. He knows when Draymond Green is out there playing center, that he can't go into the lane like he can with Bogey or Festus or whoever. But that does bring up the point of, who gets the backup center minutes? I mean,
right.
Let's say they start Draymond Green. I mean, Festus Ezeli can play out there. You've got a lot of options.
Spates, Varejao.
Yeah, there's tons, but they didn't work out in game five.
No, they haven't played that well.
So Draymond Green is going to get the majority of the minutes. And the other thing is Steve Kerr might not want to tell his guys, listen, we're kind of panicking in this scenario. We're starting Draymond Green because he's our
best
lineup.
That's sort of what I think as well.
But that's what they did last year in games 4, 5, and 6, and it worked out pretty
well.
That's
when they found the death lineup.
Yeah, that's true.
All right, final question here, Trey.
All right, whether it be James Michael McAdoo's goatee or a rebirth of Delhi Mania, I need you guys to tell me, what's the biggest X factor tonight?
This is tough. It's going to be a weird X factor because he's a two-time MVP. So Steph Curry is the X factor, but something specifically. They need to get Steph Curry more shots. He needs to shoot more, and so does Klay Thompson to some extent. I mean, you look at the numbers, these two guys, Curry and Thompson, they've taken 38% of their shots in the finals. Compare that to the two stars on the Cavs in LeBron and Kyrie, 55% nearly. They need more shots. They're amazing all-stars for a reason. They're not getting the ball enough. And they need to attack Kyrie. They need to iso Curry a little bit more, I think, and then run that 1-2 pick and roll, which the Cavs haven't had an answer for when it's Klay and Curry in the pick and roll. They switch it, and it's JR and Kyrie, and they can get shots against those guys. So I think it's get a guy like Curry more shots.
Well, two things. I think the Warriors like the fact that LeBron and Kyrie are sort of playing iso ball on the other side and getting more shots, and the Warriors are distributing it. But second, Steph is averaging 28 on the road in this series and 18 at home. So he feels, in right. terms of points per game. So he feels good on the road. I think on the sort of the supplementary players on the Warriors, Harrison Barnes was quietly very solid through four games.
And then was horrible in
game
five.
He was horrible in game
five. 2 of 14.
But this team is a comfort team. They find their comfort with the same lineups. They're creatures of habit. Yep. No Draymond Green, it kind of threw them off. Harrison back into that same role. He was fine the first four games.
When the Warriors have taken over series, it usually means Steph Curry gets going. And I think Kerr knows that, and they want to try and get him more shots tonight. I expect he'll put up a whole lot of shots. Whether they fall or not, remains to be seen. All right, we got lots more still to come here on the show when we come back. Lele joins us live from the queue in Cleveland. Yep, that's him.
Anything could still happen.
Yes, there he is, joining us live in Cleveland. Not an NBA player, I'd like to stress, but starters buddy here, Lee Ellis. All right, Lee, first things first here. Let's get into this. With Bogut out, Coach Kerr has several lineup options he can go with. Do you have any idea of who he starts tonight?
Well, it's either going to be Ezeli or Andre Iguodala. And personally, I think he's probably going to go with Andre Iguodala. They've had so much success with that lineup of death. I think it makes sense for him to start that way and try to build a lead, because I think the Warriors play best when they have a lead. And if they can put the Cavs under pressure from the start, I think that's probably a good thing. And I think if they can take the crowd out of it, that'll be very important. But, of course, the other side of the coin is if he does try to maybe start Ezeli, just so that he's got Andre Iguodala in his back pocket to come off the bench. Because we know whenever he does come on, Iggy's pretty effective. So I don't think Steve Kerr has maybe made up his mind fully yet right now. But I think the feeling is, certainly from me, is that it'll probably be Iggy from the start.
All right, we'll find out soon enough. Draymond Green, he said the Warriors would have won Game 5 if he had played. This guy is obviously fairly confident in his abilities. But what's the reaction been like from not only the Warriors or maybe even the Cavs to that sort of bold proclamation, hey, if I had played, we had won?
Yeah, well, LeBron James was asked this morning about that, and he said, it doesn't matter, we won that game. So everyone sort of feels, of course, that whatever happened, it favors them. You know, the Cavs getting the win, that was better for them. And for the Warriors, Draymond saying, hey, look, if I played, we would have won. The interesting thing was, you know, there's a lot of talk about Draymond saying, you know, people saying Draymond kind of owes his team because he let his team down. But Steve Kerr sort of swept that aside and said, look, if it wasn't for Draymond Green in the first place, we wouldn't even be here. So he's been brilliant for the last couple of years for the Warriors. And yes, he wasn't, you know, as well behaved as they would have liked him to be, maybe in this final series. But instead, if it wasn't for him doing what he's doing in the first place, then who knows where the Warriors would be. So I think Steve Kerr, he's an experienced guy, as a player and as a coach. He's trying to make sure that his guys don't have any emotional baggage when they go out in such a big game. And he knows that Draymond is an emotional guy, so you want to try to reel him in, but not too much. You want to let him still be himself and play his normal and natural game. So I think Draymond's going to be out here tonight, though, and pretty fired up and hoping to have a big game. Although we do remember last time he was sort of under the pump from the crowd. It was game 4 against the Oklahoma City Thunder, and he didn't have a great game. Of course, they went on to win that series, so he's probably overcome that, but he also probably knows from that experience what to expect tonight.
Yeah, we'll see. All right, Lee, let's put you on the spot here, man. Who wins game six tonight? What do you got? You've been wrong for every game, I feel like, over the last little while.
Yeah, that's true. I think the Warriors do close it out tonight because no team responds to a loss better than they have all season long. They've never lost two in a row other than against the Oklahoma City Thunder in the last round. So I think the Warriors know that they were a little bit below par in game five, and I think they're going to come out determined tonight to try to repeat history as well. We know it was exactly this day 12 months ago when they clinched the title, and I think they're going to try to do it again tonight. And I think it's going to be a close game, but I think the Warriors just know that it's important they shut the door tonight.
All right, Lily, final thing here. We got to give you your challenge. Now, last year, one of your challenges was to try and take down the deli burger. And
right.
You had no problem eating the burger, but you really struggled with your arch nemesis, French fries. So we want you to redeem yourself this season. We need you to find, I want you to write this down, the Fryin' Out Loud concession stand. It's near section 207, apparently. Okay. And Lee, we need you to buy the biggest amount of fries you can find at Fryin' Out Loud and take them down, mate. Come on.
What are you trying to do to me? Give me a heart attack or something.
They're just fries.
Why don't you try to make me eat all the fruit in the NBA TV green room? There's tons of
them. No, we like you struggling.
Oh, look at that. Look at that.
We like you struggling with fries. All right, so that is your challenge. Lee, best of luck with the challenge, and enjoy the game tonight, mate.
Thanks a lot, guys. See you tomorrow.
All right, good stuff. Coming up, finals MVPs, mouth guards, movies. Tass and I, we're stepping into the crossfire.
Well, it's been a while.
It's been a long time. Come on back.
Finals edition of Crossfire. This is how it works. Trey will give Skeets and me three topics. We'll debate each one, and you at home will declare the winner on Twitter. Trey, let's tell them how it works.
Yeah, if you're following along at home and you're on Twitter, you think Tass makes a good point and he's winning, tweet out hashtag Tass wins. If you think Skeets made a great point and he's winning, tweet out hashtag Skeets wins.
Let's do this.
Every tweet counts, so tweet early, tweet often. And let's get our brand new ring girl in here for round one.
Oh, man.
And guys.
What are those, LA Gears?
Light-up shoes are back, I guess,
wow.
But LeBron James is leading both teams in rebounds, assists, steals, and blocks during the finals, and he trails Kyrie Irving by just a single point for the scoring lead. If the Warriors win tonight, is LeBron still finals MVP? Here we go.
Whoa, tonight? Whoa. I think if it goes seven, LeBron's got a legitimate chance. It has to go seven. But the Warriors haven't had, even if they lose, the Warriors haven't had a dominating performance from their side. I think they'll take votes from each other because Klay under 20 points per game. Steph, I mean, he's been just under ridicule the entire series. Draymond, well, you can say he wasn't a great teammate because he got suspended. They haven't been overwhelmingly good. LeBron James has been overwhelmingly great.
He's been
I think
great.
If it goes seven, who do you vote for on the Warriors?
Well, they can decide that when they get there. There's no way LeBron wins it if the Cavs lose the series because if he didn't win it last year, he's not going to do it this year. His numbers last year are 36, 13, and 9. They're worse this year. He's been great, don't get me wrong, but there are candidates for the Warriors.
Yeah, they're not great.
Hey, if Steph Curry explodes tonight for 35-plus, very likely he could get it. Of course, Draymond Green coming back, that would be a weird situation, but he could. He's shown his worth. Klay Thompson, he goes nuts. There are candidates from the Warriors. There's no way LeBron wins it if they don't win the series.
Iggy had a better story last year. I say seven. It has to go seven, but LeBron legitimately could win it.
Wow.
All right, round two. And good news for anyone who wants to buy a chomped on Steph Curry mouth guard, because SCP Auctions is selling one of Steph's game-worn pieces. And they're expected to get at least $5,000 for that drooly piece of plastic.
$5,000.
What finals memorabilia would you pay $5,000 for?
Here we go. Wow, this is a tough question. But I'm going to go with the worst sign of all time from game five. You guys remember it, right?
You can make this sign.
Yeah, but it's
for less than $5,000.
I mean, are we gonna show it to them? I don't know it off the top of my head. It's a dang novel.
It's pretty long to remember.
But I guess not. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, it had like 1,000 words on it.
Yeah, yeah. That's
there it is.
Great, thanks guys. That one.
You're
if I lose
pay
this,
five grand for that? You
yeah,
already
because
lost.
Because it's so brutal. It's amazing in a way.
If I'm paying $5,000, I want something fantastic. I want the Heat's court from Ray Allen hit that game six shot in 2013.
About this finals.
No!
What are you talking about?
No, I'm going back 2013, all-time finals. I'm taking that court. I'm taking it home. We all heard about the stories afterwards that Ray Allen practiced this shot. He practiced this shot. I would practice it on my court that I bought for $5,000. I'm taking home the floor, the backboard, and the three-point line. And I'd practice. I'd get up off my back, like Lee Jenkins wrote about.
Yeah.
I'd trail, bang, hit it.
All right, you know the rules here, Skeets. There are no rules.
This one's falling apart.
But here for round three, our final round, and according to several reports, wow, LeBron James has watched some form of The Godfather six times during the playoffs. But here's what I want to know. What movie should LeBron have been watching during the playoffs? Here we go.
I think he should have been watching The Martian, because I think he must feel like Matt Damon on Mars at times, all alone,
really,
trying to get his teammates to help him out. LeBron, you got to realize you need your teammates. You're Matt Damon in The Martian. You're a botanist.
No, the answer, if you've been watching the show or listened to the show over the last 10 years, the answer is Rad, okay?
What?
It is the 1986 BMX movie starring Crew Jones, a young guy.
LeBron was 1 year old probably when that came out.
He has the intensity and the desire to win the BMX race Hell Track. The NBA Finals are LeBron's Hell Track. The Splash Brothers are the Reynolds twins, Rod and Rex. Draymond Green is Bart Taylor. LeBron, that's an inspirational movie, and it's got the greatest soundtrack of all time from John Farnham. Shout out to Australia. Okay. It's amazing. Get ready to break
if it's
the
not gonna
ice.
Be Martian.
Feels like time is standing still. So that is the movie he should have been watching. Godfather's good, though.
Yeah, Godfather is good, but Tess wins.
Wow.
I think people didn't hear enough of your singing there, Skeets.
Yeah, I think when they didn't put that sign up,
that
killed me.
Oh,
up there. All right, we gotta take a break when we come back. We'll revisit the Game 5's biggest storylines.
Hey, it's the NBA Finals. Every game is a blowout.
Game 6 of the Finals tonight, 9 p.m. Eastern on ABC. But before we get to that, let's refresh your memory by revisiting the major storylines from Game 5.
At number 5, Draymond Green couldn't be in the building, so he hung out in a suite across the street in the Oakland Coliseum with Warriors GM Bob Myers. Classy move right there. At number 4, the first half scoring, no one could be stopped. It was 61s at half. Klay scored his series high in the first half of this game with 26. LeBron at 25 at the break, highest scoring first half of an NBA Finals game in his career, aided a little bit by Draymond Green's absence, but it only got worse in the second half for the Dubs when Bogut went down with a knee injury. It was a three-point game when Bogey went down. But regardless, this night belonged to LeBron James and Kyrie Irving. It's hard to choose who to put at number 2 and who to put at number 1, but we'll go with LBJ first because he did pop most of his 41 points early in dominating fashion. And we'll go with Kyrie at number 1 because he scored most of his 41 late. Kyrie's performance had legend Isaiah Thomas dancing in the NBA TV green room. Like Kyrie was dancing on the Warriors. First teammates to score 40 in an NBA Finals game, special night.
What happens tonight? Are these finals over or are we going to Game 7, baby? What do the people say?
It looks like we got the Cavs. People think the Cavs are going to win, and I kind of tend to side with them.
Wow. Well, we'll find out soon enough. We'll be back tomorrow night, 6:30 p.m. regardless, and we got the drop tomorrow morning. Catch that on iTunes and Google Play Music.
All right. Can't wait. Thank you for joining us, folks. And remember, when you get a promotion, don't forget where you came from.
Brace the night, people. Enjoy the game.